we call this the International Space Station. It cost $130 billion. How much of it do you think you guys paid for out of $130?
All of it.
Almost all of it, $100 billion. So I read an article somewhat tongue-in-cheek saying that SpaceX should send a Dragon capsule to the space station with seven Navy SEALs on it and send the Russians packing and get the hell off of our space station. But again, we have this globalist perspective. We insist on calling it the International Space Station and pretending that, that there's a coalition working on it, just like we pretend that there's a coalition in Afghanistan or Iraq trying to help us fight wars. It's delusional. Jeff Bezos, luckily, has launched a company called Blue Origin, another private space company located in Washington, doing operations in Texas. They're developing new engines, hopefully for United Launch Alliance to replace the 3180s. But, unfortunately, Senator Richard Shelby of Alabama, who has a vested interest in the integration of these Russian engines, has continued to block legislation put forward by John McCain and others to prevent the import of these engines because he wants to keep his constituents in the jobs in Huntsville, Alabama, beating the jobs in Hawthorne, California. And this is endemic of a constant problem we have in the United States, is that our states think that their competitors are the other states. So if Jerry Brown can make a deal with China in order to screw Texas, he'll do that in a heartbeat. And if the governor of Texas can come to California and steal American jobs and take them to Texas, he's happy to do that too. I guarantee you that the provincial governor of a Chinese province that tried to take jobs from another state-owned enterprise in China when he could have taken them from the Americans would be put up against the wall and shot. And we have to take a much more pro-American attitude towards these things instead of a state-by-state competitive approach. I'm happy to say I wrote an article on what I call our dangerous partnership with Russia in the Washington Times, and McCain called this a must-read. He's been a trooper on this issue of getting rid of the Russian engines. But we're still suicidal. Another really great example of this, I think, was Alibaba raising a huge amount of money, the biggest IPO ever in American history on the American Stock Exchange. Anybody buy some Alibaba stock? You may not know it, but there's a good chance you've got it in your investment portfolio if you let your investment manager stick you in one of these diversified portfolio management schemes, or you own some funds that you don't dig into and see what you've got. Guess what, though? You don't actually own any Alibaba. What do you own? Anybody know? Yeah, you own some shares in an interesting illegal structure, at least illegal as far as the Chinese government is concerned, whereby you have shares in a holding company in the Cayman Islands that purports to be capable of forwarding profits from Alibaba to you should they ever exist, but you have absolutely no corporate oversight. You have absolutely no traditional governance, say, as a shareholder in this company. It's one of the reasons that the Hong Kong Stock Exchange wouldn't allow Alibaba to do their IPO there. But for some reason, they were allowed to come here in the United States to do something that would certainly not be permitted for a U.S. company and that the Chinese government has actually said is illegal, and take the largest chunk of American capital ever, send it to China to do what with? Well, Alibaba's stated purpose is to destroy American companies like Amazon and eBay. This is not a formula for national success, to set up a system where we allow foreign companies to behave in a way that we don't allow American companies to, that we basically throw our capital and retirement savings at them and then hand them our technology so that we can ask them to please come put our companies out of business. And who does Jack Ma want to kill next? Well, he wants to kill off PayPal. What did PayPal ever do for us? Well, Elon Musk took the money from PayPal and started SpaceX and Hawthorne, which is the probably fastest growing employer in the Los Angeles area now. Started Tesla, which is probably Northern California's top manufacturing company, employment dollar-wise. We get things from these internet companies to let them be predatorily attacked, particularly by Chinese companies who do not have a reciprocal market access regime going. Can you use Facebook or Twitter in China now? No, you can't, but we allow WeChat, we allow all their companies to not only come over here and operate and compete, but to collect our capital. Not only that, our schools are full of computer science majors that are being trained using our best advantage in order to make their companies stronger and better in their closed market. For some reason, our trade authorities would first address these issues of lack of market access for internet companies. Why do they do that? Because the Chinese say, oh, we're not blocking you for market access, it's just this censorship thing because we hate free speech. And that's okay. Why is that okay? Because Bill Clinton removed human rights as a criteria for trade from our trade policy, where it had been a long-standing a feature of our trade regime. And in the mid-90s, in order to give China a pass on Tiananmen Square, he decided it's okay if companies want to block free speech, for instance. That ends up being a great disadvantage to American companies who depend on things like the right to free speech in order to compete. So can you go buy a Chinese media company? No. Can you even get your films into the Chinese market on a reliable manner? No. American film companies are highly restricted in their ability to get into the Chinese market, so they constantly pander. It's one of the reasons you see so many films that feature China in them now. It's the hopes that the Chinese will actually allow that particular Hollywood film to be shown in China. But China came over here and bought the entire AMC theater chain, and we allowed that. If we tried to buy a theater chain in China, the answer would be no, that's a national security issue. The other thing that amazes me when we come to national security is this assumption that superior American technology will always protect us from countries like China, which have inferior technologies. I'd like to point out who had the best technology in World War II. The Germans. They had long-range rockets. In fact, the V-2 was the first vehicle to go into space in October of 1942. That's when the space race began, actually not 1957. They had the best tanks. They had the biggest battleship. They had the best submarines. They had jet planes. They actually had rocket-powered planes, too. Did they win? No, they didn't win, and the reason they didn't win is because we had production capacity. There's a story in my book, Death by China, that we relay, where a German military commander was captured, and he was running a couple of artillery guns whose job it was to keep American armor from coming into to Germany from the south after the Americans took Italy. And he said that he was sitting there with his pair of 80mm guns, and that every time an American tank came down the road, his guys took them out. And his American captor said, so what are you doing here then if you guys are so great? And he said, it's simple. We ran out of ammunition before you ran out of tanks. Productive capacity is what wins wars, and it doesn't make a difference whether your stuff is better or not. We had a lot of tanks. They couldn't make enough ammunition. We won. Today I get people saying, don't worry, the F-22 is the air superiority fighter of the 21st century. It can take on any other aircraft in the sky. It'll shoot down three of the Chinese J-20s before they even get close enough to cause any problems. Do I feel secure? Well, the problem is we have 187 of these, and we're never, ever, ever going to have any more because they're too expensive to make. The Chinese, they make things. Okay, so they're going to take out three of these with every one of ours, but what are we going to do about this, okay? When 1,000 of them come over the Taiwan Strait, I don't care. If we send all of our 187 planes over there, we're good. Our friends in China, meanwhile, are continuing to expand territorially. One of the stories they like to tell is that China is never an aggressor, that China has always been the victim, that foreign colonial powers came over and abused China, and that it's just a sweet little country minding its own business. The fact of the matter is China has been an aggressive, expansionist territorial empire for thousands of years. It started out very small, and it continued to encompass and steal territory from all of the kingdoms around it. Most recently, it took over an area that was called East Turkestan that they call Xinjiang Province. That's where the Muslim Uyghurs are fighting a guerrilla battle against the Chinese. They took over Tibet in the 1950s. They invaded Vietnam in the 1970s after we left. Most people don't know that. They're now claiming the large parts of the South China Sea and building artificial islands there, which they are reinforcing with missiles and additional military capabilities. They've been threatening the Japanese over islands that are in dispute. Now, this is interesting because the only claim that the Chinese can make to those islands is that they belong to Taiwan. How many of you think Taiwan is part of China? Our government seems to think Taiwan is part of China. They even make Taiwan go to the Olympics under the name Chinese Taipei. Just so you have clarification on this, neither Tibet nor Taiwan were ever part of a unified Chinese empire. The Yuan dynasty, founded by the Mongols, invaded China and took over Tibet at the same time, and that is how China claims that they own Tibet, because they were both invaded by the Mongols. It's similar to the Vichy French, gave the French a claim to Poland, because both of them were conquered by the Germans at the same time. It's a ridiculous assumption. The claim to Taiwan is even sillier. Taiwan was part of the Rikyu Empire, a separate empire, and it had its own culture and people. It was colonized by the Dutch, and the Chinese took Taiwan from the Dutch in the 17th century. It was quickly snapped away from them by the Japanese and held for quite some time. At the end of World War II, the Americans basically gave the Japanese Okinawa and they gave the Chinese Taiwan. The Chinese nationalist Chiang Kai-shek fled to Taiwan, but it was never ever ruled by Beijing in a peaceful manner. It was stolen property. China, of course, is threatening to attack Taiwan. He would now like to remain independent. There's almost nobody in Taiwan now that they've got rid of the last independent government that they had and wants to be part of China. China is threatening Vietnam in the South China Sea. China is having armed conflict with the Philippines already and is pushing on that. Malaysia and China are at odds. Basically, every single neighbor of China, from India to Japan, is preparing for war with the country. Obama's biggest foreign policy and national security move has been his so-called Asia pivot, something that hasn't worked very well, but has cost us a lot of money and a lot of talk. And it just seems odd to me that he hosts state dinners for a country that he's preparing for World War III with, and that does everything that we possibly can to increase our trade with the country that we're preparing for World War III with. And now he presents us with the Trans-Pacific Partnership and claims that it will contain China. That's one of the arguments you'll hear. Oh, we need to do business with all these other countries in Asia in order to contain China. Well, here's a quote from Hillary Clinton, who, mark my words, is a big supporter of TPP, and no matter what she said, to get Bernie Sanders' votes will absolutely flip when she wins this election and push TPP first thing. She said, we're offering assist with capacity building so that every country in Asia can eventually join. So, not only do we want all these Asian countries to join, but we want to help build up their manufacturing capacity so they can get into this market and compete with us. And we welcome the interest of any nation willing to meet 21st century standards as embodied in the TPP, which doesn't take much since Malaysia, Brunei, and Vietnam qualify, including China. They want China in this plan. It is not a China containment policy. It is a charade to get China in. Now, why is Taiwan not in the TPP they'd like to be? Because, of course, we've made a deal with China that that they can't come in until China comes in. The other thing that's really important to understand is where our supply chain is. Since we've decided to outsource our entire supply chain, most of it is going to East Asia. If it's not going to China, it's going to countries like Vietnam and Malaysia, South Korea, Japan. This is the territorial claim that China is making in the South China Sea, as well as the East China Sea. The South China Sea claim is particularly galling. It's almost as though Mexico claimed they own the entire Gulf of Mexico because it was called the Gulf of Mexico, which would include the coast of, say, Mississippi, Georgia, and Florida, as well as all the Caribbean islands. It's about 1,500 miles south from any actual Chinese territory to the lowest point that they're claiming. It's absurd, and it's only 200 miles off the coast of any of their neighbors, or less in many points. They're basically telling the Vietnamese no ship can pull in and out of the Vietnamese port without crossing Chinese territory. So why do we care about this? Well, it's because we're sending all of our manufacturing, much of our military manufacturing over here. We can't make a chip in the United States anymore. The last trusted chip foundry in the United States was bought out by a UAE company just a few months ago. So there are no manufacturers of integrated circuits in the United States that are owned by a U.S. company. We're getting them from over here. Why does this concern me? It concerns me because China's building military bases here, and within days they'll be able to disable our access to any supplies from any of these locations. We, meanwhile, theoretically, we have to create some sort of armed flotilla to escort our supplies all the way across the Pacific Ocean under threat of Chinese missile and naval and aircraft attack. I think that's completely unrealistic, and maybe you would find that these facilities would all be shut down. And most of these countries, when intimidated by a potential Chinese invasion, would simply fold and stop delivering products to the United States. I own a company that makes a skateboard. We manufacture a skateboard out of carbon fiber composite materials. Upcycled from the aerospace industry, and I was trying to make sure that every single component of the skateboard was American made. And one of the things we were trying to find was skateboard bearings that are made in the U.S. It's getting increasingly hard to find very small things like simple hardware nuts and bolts and bearings that are made in the United States. That you know, for any thing except the most highly specialized military products. And I'm talking to this distributor, and he's a Chinese gentleman, and he's trying to actually help me find some American-made bearings because he owns most of the distribution market. And he says to me, you know, during World War II, the Allies had to bomb the ball bearing factories in Osaka and Kyoto over and over and over again in order to stop that production. We're not going to have to do that to you.